I just wanted to understand, you talked a lot about that, you know, India is a very complex market and there are different people, you know, with different attitudes, and therefore you can't really force people to comply, like you give the example. But you still need to take people along, right? So how do you go about doing that in the new order? What should managers do now that you can't make people comply? You still got to need to take people along.
See,
right?
You have to it's constant negotiation.
Right.
So it's, as I said, it's not efficient. It's not like I've given a diktat and everybody's going to follow it. They're not going to follow it.
Right.
So you work with the assumption that you're not going to do it. And you're constantly negotiating, following it up. And that's the model that I talk about, where you're constantly communicating,
right,
like Vishnu's shankh,
right,
chakra, review.
Right.
Vishnu ka gada, discipline, and
right,
padma, recognition. But going again and again and again and again, it never ends.
Right. But since everybody has their own agendas or their own attitudes, how do you get them to come to, you know, that?
See, when I believe that you are enabling me to grow, when I genuinely believe that you are going to enable me to grow in whatever way we negotiate, then I will follow you. I'll always follow the person who enables me to grow.
Mm-hmm.
In now, growth ka definition will vary. Some people say I want to grow spiritually. Somebody say I want to make money. I want to make career. Somebody else say I just want bonus. I don't want to do anything else. Mm-hmm. That conversation happens. That I trust you. That my growth karega.
Right.
He'll put me in the right ecosystem. He will help me grow.
Right.
So I then start getting energized in your presence.
Right.
Because you're constantly enabling me to grow. So I am the person who enables others to grow. And by enabling others to grow, I grow.
Right.
So my business expands because I create so many leaders who are entering different markets and constantly enabling them to grow rather than punishing them, threatening them.
So in a way, what you're saying is the leader's role is to create, to be
more
an enabler and you know, create more leaders who
will. So his primary role is to create more yajmans, create more people who will take proactive decisions and sort out problems and take responsibility for successes and failures.
And your definition of yajman is in a way like somebody who's proactive and sort of not reactive.
Proactive and responsible.
And responsible. And how do you create that mindset for people to be more yajman, right? With most of the people in a lot of Indian organizations, there's this, you know, we'll do as much as.
No, but it's a global organization also.
Yeah,
everywhere
absolutely,
in the world.
Absolutely.
It's just that in a global organization, there's an ecosystem that allows me to thrive. It's not happening in India at the rate it should.
Right.
Because I think our leaders are very insecure. So at one level, our leaders are insecure. At another level, the models that we have are all process-driven.
Correct.
So two things are happening, right?
Right.
But what we need is more enlightened leaders who are enabling others to grow. So look at our political establishment. The old order is not letting the young order grow.
Right.
You're surrounded by old people who are controlling everything. Bhishma Pitama ban gaye sab log.
Exactly.
You know, so we're not letting anybody grow. And that is not good for the economy. That's not good for the country.
So how do you bring this, you know,
there'll be an Arjun who will ensure that the Bhishma Pitama is pinned to the ground.
Right.
He may not be killed, but he'll be pinned to the ground. And it is happening in some quarters.
The other good example that you gave, really liked it about, was the photograph of Apple and you know, the Vishnu, the Lakshmi chases Vishnu. But obviously Apple didn't go about doing it consciously, like, you know, yajna mentality. But what is the yajna mentality?
But he did. You see, if I look at whatever I've read, I don't know Steve.
Okay,
I don't.
Yeah.
When I see Steve Jobs, I don't know much about him. But
right,
what I read about him, he is very sensitive to what the customer wants. So he understood what the customer wants. So he created honey and the bees came to him.
Right.
So he knew the customer wants honey. So every product of his was one honey. Now everybody was creating products. What did he do differently?
Correct.
His customer insight was far more, he was far more sensitive and caring.
And that, you think, comes from a yajna mentality?
Yeah, because he's looking at the customer. Na, wo devata ko dekh ke bol raha hai, ye main tumhe swaha de raha hu, wo tathastu aa jata hai.
Right.
It's, if I replace the word looking at the devata with customer insight, it sounds so rational.
Right.
Yeah? But it is customer insight. But if such a simple thing like Philip Kotler talks about customer insight, why did Steve Jobs succeed where others didn't?
Right.
He had an individual, he was of course idiosyncratic. He was one of these unusually brilliant men. But I'm saying that, look at the mindset. He's constantly sensitive to the audience.
Right. And that's, you think, is the main thing.
And the audience can be your employee.
It can be your employee, it can be your customer,
so
it could be your
boss. So you don't let a strike take place. You figure out when there's restlessness in the union. Why is a union leader emerging? Is it because the people are not happy?
Right.
When does a union leader emerge? When or are they lazy or something's going wrong? So how do I... Now what we do, if you attack it with force rather than empathy.
Right.
He will become stronger and stronger and stronger. In the end, nobody wins because the industry will collapse, everything will collapse.
Exactly.
But if you're a Vishnu, you'll say, okay, maybe there's an intelligent guy. Can I give him a managerial position? Can I work towards? What is the real problem the organization is actually facing? Maybe those people are underpaid and exploited. Am I investing enough time and telling them that, listen, I can't, what am I doing? the harsh realities of the environment. So
it's really the empathy and bhavna that you're talking about.
It's important. It's not that they're going to be happy, everything will be sorted out hunky-dory. There's a nasty way to do things, there's a nice way to do things.
Right.
But everything doesn't have to be nasty.
Right.
In fact, 90% of life's problems don't need nastiness.
Right.
But we seem to think today that everything has to be done nasty.
Right. Well, you work with a lot of Indian companies as well. Do you see the same mentality like Apple and any of the Indian companies you've helped imbibe this philosophy?
Most Indian companies function with the Indra and Daksha mindset.
Okay.
Even from the smallest to the largest company. So there's one saying that I should get and you should not get anything.
Right.
So the exploitative mindset. The other is the paternalistic controlling mindset.
Right.
That's why we're not growing big.
Right.
So even the biggest companies in India are resource heavy. They are in manufacturing. They are not in service sector.
Great.
They are not creating leaders.
Right.
So we're not creating leaders today. We are just, this Daksha will never create a leader. He'll be a bargat ka ped.
And so changing this mindset in Indian companies is a huge challenge. How are you doing it at Pantaloon and, you know, just changing your whole belief system?
My job is not to change beliefs.
Right.
I am making people aware that if you want to make money,
right.
See, you are telling people that if you want to make money, you have to change. But you're not, if people don't want to make money, so they're not changing.
Right.
It's as simple as that. If you don't believe that you have to be Vishnu, then Lakshmi will never follow you.
Right.
So it's as simple, it sounds so simple, right?
Right.
Be Vishnu, Lakshmi will come to you. But everybody wants to be Daksha.
Right. Well, what does be Vishnu mean, like, in you know?
It's, where the focus of your life is to enable people to grow.
That's it.
Constantly. So if I want to become a 100 crore company to a 1,000 crore company, how do I enable every person who's handling 10 crores today to make 100 crores?
Right. What about SMEs, sir? So a lot of these things, you know, for a large company, it's already very secure. It's not thinking so much about itself. And therefore, as a leader also of a large organization, you can think about enabling.
You can't, because the shareholder is not going to love you. The shareholder wants more and more and more and more and more. The shareholders are greedy.
Right.
They're going to let you with 1 pound of flesh going away. So we, in a shareholder-driven organization, the shareholder is actually the yajman, who is deciding that everybody should be. And the shareholder is Indra. And therefore, the CEO becomes Daksha Prajapati.
Right.
It's not an enabling mindset. How do we create more entrepreneurs? How do we create more businesses? How do I create more? That's not the focus area of the boardroom discussion.
Right.
It's like, you know, we need more markets. We need to develop so much talent. This is what we have to work towards. For example, now in the world, everybody's talking that women should be in the boardroom. Now that's a thrust, right?
Right.
So in the same thrust, look at it. So it shakes things. People change things. People question things. In the same way, we are talking about talent management. We are only talking of top line and bottom line. We are not talking about talent management. Ultimately, it's about talent management. Top line and bottom line is outcome.
Outcome of.
But here they are saying that everything is about top line and bottom line. People are enablers. The people only exist to do that. So our focus is different.
Right.
What is the focus area? For most people, the focus area is the balance sheet.
Correct.
I'm saying shift it to talent management. That's all I'm saying. It doesn't mean balance sheet won't happen. Because the assumption is that if the people are talented, they'll make more money.
Right.
But you are saying, no, I want to be balance sheet. Talent.
I don't care so much about.
Notwithstanding.
No, exactly.
I want the balance sheet.
Yeah.
That is a dark mindset, which is basically saying that, you know, so mera paisa chahiye mujhe talent. Talent, haan, theek hai, it's important.
And it's so simple and so appealing, your philosophy.
Because it demands humans to expand their mind. And please, next, the Western model basically says your mind cannot be expanded.
Right.
All can be expanded is your wealth. And the assumption is if you have more wealth, you become generous.
Right.
I've never understood this. But how rich people become generous? Because it doesn't make logical sense to me at all. But the assumption is if you're rich, you should be doing social responsibility. Sir, how did that bhav come?
Right.
Charity is not generosity.
Right. So it's here.
Nobody talks in terms of emotional transformation, intellectual transformation. We only talk about material transformation because material things are measurable.
Right.
Emotions cannot be measured.
Right.
Intellect cannot be measured. I can measure your skills. I can't measure your enabling abilities.
Right.
And when you think about it, we're talking about shifting focus to people management, getting people into the markets to make money, go and make it, get it happen.
Can you share some examples where you helped this transformation happen through?
I don't help people do that. I just talk people to people.
Yes, but I'm sure
that's not my key performance indicator.
Right. You also talked about this nice example of Rama and Krishna, you know, in the leadership context. Which do you have a personal preference for which?
Vishnu.
Vishnu.
If you want money, if you don't want money, then magaj mari niche Shivji ban jao. But if you want to make money, it's Vishnu. which means adapting constantly to different situations. You can't have one or the other, then you're stupid.
Right. So you need to have a...
Because the market will change whether you like it or not.
Right.
Then how will you survive?
Right. So you need to be both in sort of...
Different situations.
In different situations. And how do you kind of decide which situation you've got to be what?
Become Vishnu.
So that comes first and then... Everything.
Because you know the gaze, you understand the market, then you decide your intervention point. This is the avatar I need. I have to be Vishnu. I have to be this avatar. I have to be that avatar. In different contexts, I have to be different. I have to constantly adapt. Vishnu is very much like the Indian person working.
Right.
But the question is, for whose benefit is he working? For his benefit or for the people's benefit? Udhar ke liye or to make profit for himself? So that's the whole thing. He's working for talent management. He's not working for bottom alignment.
Talent management enabling. So this is the key thought that I'm getting.
But enabling people to do better constantly. That's all we have to focus on.
And so as a consequence, the balance sheet.
That'll happen. You have right nice people.
But people are so short-term oriented, right? And so if, even if you
because
want to do
Because I don't
do
trust people, I trust money. People bhag jayenge, paisa nahi bhagega.
Right.
So I don't trust, the CEO will run away, but the money will stay with me. So it's a basic insecurity of our minds. And the whole thought thinking system is things. Material.
Absolutely.
It's not people. So in all over the world, we...
How do you relax this insecurity, like, you know?
Well, you can't. This is the way the world has always been.
Right.
You're not going to change the world and one day everybody will be happy. No, it's not going to happen. You'll have Indra all the time, Daksha all the time. But are we aware of alternate discourses?
Right.
We are being told this discourse is not even being heard.
Right.
Where is this discourse?
Absolutely.
It doesn't exist. I have brought it to the limelight today. I'm asking people, let's at least talk about this discourse. I'm still talking about money. I'm still talking about business. I'm still talking about affluence, prosperity. But I'm just approaching it differently.
And you seem to be very accepting of, you know, these issues that are there, but you're saying it's reality and just take it as it is.
Because that's the Indian way. It's sanatan hai, thodi na badalta hai. The Western model wants to change the world.
Yeah.
It's an evangelical model.
Correct.
It's, I want to change, I want to turn, everybody should do corporate social responsibility.
Right.
Everybody should colonize. 100 years ago, everybody was talking about colonization. Today, we are talking about corporate social responsibility. We are always selling an idea.
Right.
Indian thought is transform yourself. Why do you want to sell the idea? People will change.
Right.
You become Ram, you become Vishnu, things will change. Why are you so busy selling an idea?
So it's really about making other, the Western model is making other people change, that's what you're saying.
Well, Indian model is about you changing.
It's you changing.
So it's not about evangelization, it is about transformation yourself. I am Indra by nature, default button is Indra.
Right.
I have to work towards Vishnu. Baki sab ho jayega.
And how does this transformation happen? Like, what is
introspection, constant feedback about what is happening in the market. So if you want to be a good public speaker, keep noticing how many people are yawning all the time. Now either you can tell them don't yawn or make it so interesting that stop yawning. Daksha model is, agar yawn karoge to punishment milega.
Right.
Vishnu model is, I will charm you that you'll never get out of your seats.
Right.
Which model do you think I follow?
Right. You're Krishna, sir. More like. It's really wonderful talking to you.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.